Other day I was on YouTube killing some time, I mean learning some new stuff, and I saw the Steve Mould and ElectroBOOM videos about the Mould effect, each one trying to explain it in a different way. After that I looked for other videos trying to explain the effect, and in the end I was not totally satisfied with any of them. So I decided to try to explain it in a different way. After all, I'm a mechanical engineer, so I think I'm not
overqualified
for this task. Well, before we start, for those that are not aware, the Mould effect occurs when you drop a chain from a container at a certain height, and as the chain falls, we observe this siphon-like effect automatically emptying the container and creating a raised loop much higher than the edge of the container. This is sometimes called as the chain fountain effect, and it was known way before Mould popularized it. Well, these are the important elements of the problem. A chain with connected elements, a container or surface at an elevation which holds the coiled chain, an initial condition which primes the flow of the chain, and a force which maintains the flow of the chain. Well, what I believe is working here is a whip effect. Like when you flick a rope, waves are formed that travel through the rope. Who else as a kid played with the rope by making ripples and watching how they move? But wait, in the Mould effect, we have a chain and not a rope. And we don't have a wave traveling in the chain, have we? And what does the whip have to do with it? Let's slow down a little. I'm getting a bit ahead of myself. First, a quick analysis of the forces. Each element of the chain is under the effect of the force of gravity acts the same way on all elements, always in the downward direction. Each element acts on its neighboring elements with tensile forces on the links. The inertial force arises when an element is accelerated, and it always resists the force which is being applied. We have a support force from the container and the ground, which acts against the force of gravity for the elements which are still inside the container or already hit the ground. If instead of a chain we use a rope and discretize it in the small elements, we will have the same forces acting on each one of them. On YouTube there are some videos of people who use ropes instead of chains. The effect works in the same way. Even that weird central vacuum system from Mehdi is more like a rope than a chain. But the effect it shows seems a bit different from the Mould effect. Okay, sure it works with ropes. But how does the Mould effect really work? I think we can all agree that the most important force here is the one pulling the end of the chain. It is responsible for keeping the chain in motion. At the other end, we have the coiled end of the chain, where each element is stationary until the next element starts pulling it and it starts to move. So far, all normal. This should happen with any rope or chain falling from a raised surface to a lower one. How does the raised loop form? In some cases, we have to give it a helping hand. We can see it especially on the 2D experiments or the chain sitting on a flat surface from Mehdi. But when we have a container or a raised edge, the wave can start spontaneously, depending on the type of the chain, and some things may help this wave to form itself. Like the impacts with the edge of the container, the bending resistance of the chain, the vibrations in the chain that come from its disposition inside the container. Without the edge, the chain could curve straight down and not show the effect. That's why it has to be prime when there's no edge, or if the edge offers too much resistance to the movement of the chain. The bending resistance may help to guide the chain, but it is not launching itself up by kicking against the bottom of the container. The vibrations of the chain that come from its disposition on the container, to me, are the key to this process. We can clearly see some smaller waves going through the chain. Those smaller waves make the tension fluctuate, and sometimes it gets smaller than the tension on the side that is pulling down. When this happens, the chain overshoots. I guess those are the kicks the guys from Cambridge were searching for. The way we pull the chain up and then down with this abrupt change in direction is basically equivalent to a pulse on a rope. It travels in the direction of the container. I call this the bigger wave. But wait, Why did I mention a whip? Well, this was the first association I made. Because when this chain runs out, it whips in the air. This is exactly what is happening with the vacuum hose. As we get near the chip, there's less mass to pull, so it accelerates and whips. But if you make a pulse on a rope, you will see that it fades as it travels along, because it's dissipating that energy. There has to be a way for the bigger wave to sustain itself. We can clearly see that it grows, so it has to get energy from somewhere. Well, the smaller waves travel in the opposite direction, from the container to the ground. So maybe we can think this in terms of interference between waves. When two waves travel in opposite directions in the same medium, we get constructive interference when two crests or two troughs align, and destructive interference when the crest aligns with a trough. If it was only that, the bigger wave should only fluctuate up and down with the smaller waves, but never grow. So there has to be something else going on. My hypothesis is that those smaller waves reflect back at this portion where the chain is pulled straight down, at least partially. Waves normally reflect when they encounter a barrier. I think this change in direction can be considered as such. This way we track part of the smaller waves and its energy on the peak of the bigger wave, which is accumulated as potential energy, making the loop grow. To test this hypothesis, we could try to suppress those waves by straightening the chain before it is pulled. This could be done with some type of guide, but it may be argued that the losses are just too high, slowing down the chain and preventing the effect that way. We would have to need to measure the velocity of the chain with and without the guide to see if there's significant difference. Other way in which we could test this is by laying the chain straight on a surface, like a table, and make it fall over the edge. But we need a raised edge with low resistance, or else we have to prime the bigger wave by giving it a flick. In those experiments, if the loop grows, then my hypothesis must be false. I don't have a chain of steel beads with several meters to test this. Hey, maybe those 10,000 Canadian cents could be put to good use. But I have something else. Computer simulations. I thought about making one myself, but this would have taken some time. And I found this nice simulation made by Matt Palermo, which runs directly on the browser. In this simulation, we don't have the bending resistance between the elements, but the Mould effect happens anyway. The model consists of points of mass connected by elastic links and includes the force of gravity and interactions with the container and the floor. For my hypothesis, the most relevant parameter here is the beaker width. Unfortunately, it is not possible to eliminate the smaller waves. But we can change its frequency and amplitude by making the container narrower. The effect still happens, but the chain does not rise as much as before. Of course, this does not prove much, but it looks promising. In relation to the Mehdi and Mould debate, I would say that I'm more on the side of Mehdi. The experiments were very interesting and basically debunked the Cambridge hypothesis adopted by Steve Mould. But neither of them mentioned the effect of the waves. And probably there may be some other relevant factors that I may be unaware of. If you wanna play with the simulation too, I will link it in the video description. And I really hope I didn't mess up with my explanations. Thanks for watching, and until the next time.